Programming is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional funding provided by...
Thanks to SDN Communications CyberRx Security Risk Review, Lucy has a complete IT game plan. She can also rotate from station to station at 1.2 meters per second, rating Lucy's foot speed amongst the elite at her position, allowing her to get the most out of SDN's reliable broadband network and its full suite of managed cybersecurity services. Even IT pros up their game when they partner with SDN. Enjoy the uptime.
Rural electric cooperatives were the first to bring power to the prairie. Today, we're bringing you the tools, technology, and economic development support to help realize this region's full potential. You are our member owners. Together, we are re-energizing rural.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Hello and welcome to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live coverage of the governor's budget address. I'm Stephanie Rissler alongside Lee Strubinger. In just a few minutes, Governor Dennis Daugaard will deliver his budget recommendations for fiscal year 2019, which will mark his last budget address as the governor of South Dakota.
We do know the governor is going to be recommending a very cautious budget this year due to lower than expected revenue generation. Since the start of the fiscal year, revenue collections are down by about $8 million. And that's due to a few several things. One is a sluggish ag economy. The state is also missing out on some internet sales tax collections. And also the rising cost of health care is really making it hard for South Dakotans to have some of that disposable income to go spend their money.
He'll lay out all of his plans here in just a few minutes. We're waiting for the governor to enter the House of Representatives. Right now, Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels has taken to the podium. We'll now go down to the floor.
Remember him, but all of us, I would ask, as we continue to walk, to encourage young people and others serving to take into mind, and especially what the Rapid City Journal has said, is establishing an award, which is nice, but there are many people who are civil in their public service. And contrary to what we might see daily on media, that is not true in South Dakota, that people are, we are very civil. And I think to continue that in Craig's image, I know he and his family would appreciate that. We'll see you again, Craig, my brother. In accordance with the South Dakota Constitution, the governor shall propose to you a budget in which the expenditures or appropriations may not exceed anticipated revenue and existing funds available for expenditure appropriations. The appropriations by you, the legislature, may not exceed anticipated revenue and existing funds available for expenditure or appropriation. Accordingly, the governor, through his Bureau of Finance and Management, shall prepare and submit to you a budget with copies, therefore, for you today, not later than the first Tuesday after the first Monday of December. Will the Sergeant-at-Arms please announce the presence of our governor? Please announce. Ladies and gentlemen, in just a minute, we will have the Sergeant-at-Arms come up and announce the governor. We'll stand by for just a couple of minutes as the Sergeant-at-Arms, who has arms and is a sergeant. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Sergeant-at-Arms.
Well, Mr. Michaels, last year you did this, so you caught me a little off guard, but I'm more than pleased to introduce our governor.
It's quarterback Michaels.
So. Yeah, all right. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, people of South Dakota, please welcome our honorable governor, Dennis Daugaard. Thank you very much. Thank you, and thank you for that moving tribute to our good friend Craig Teason. I know we were all shocked when we heard the news about Craig, and as so many of you voiced so eloquently, he was a consummate public servant, and from the Peace Corps to his long service as a law enforcement service to our friendship with him and his service as a legislator, he never let his preconceived notions get in the way. He was always a good listener, a good debater, respectful always. He took his time to make the best decision. We are going to be missing him, but he is a great example to us all. My duty today is to offer a proposed budget for fiscal year 2019. And in today's speech, I'll review the state's economy, our current year revenues and expenses, and offer my proposals for next year. The Bureau of Finance and Management releases monthly revenue updates on its website every month, and if you follow those, you know that the state's revenue collections have not been meeting projections for the year we're in right now. Today, I'll propose expense reductions and one-time revenue to bridge that gap. But despite that weakness in revenue, revenue is still growing, albeit slowly, and by next June, at the end of the fiscal year, we should have enough revenue growth to structurally balance the fiscal year 2019 budget. But let's begin by looking back over the past year to see the challenges that we have already overcome. Fiscal year 2017 was challenging because of weak revenue then as well. We had to revise our revenue estimates down as we moved through the fiscal year. The adopted revenue estimate seen here was just short of $1.6 billion of projected revenue, and that was adopted in February of 2016, several months before the fiscal year even started. Then a year ago in December, at this speech, I proposed a downward revision of about $12 million lower as revenue was less than projected for fiscal year 17. Then last March, when you convened, the legislature adopted a revenue estimate which was lower by still another $22 million, $22.3. And then, when we finally closed the book in 2017, actual revenue was lower by still another $7.6 million. All told, compared to the original adopted estimate, we had stair-stepped our ways down a total of $42 million. Fortunately, we were able to balance the budget through reduced spending. This next chart adds all the expense levels for each iteration of the FY2017 budget, which is represented by the red bars you can see. Each time our revenue estimate was lowered, we cut expenses to maintain balance. And as we approached year end, seeing continued revenue weakness and uncertain where revenue would ultimately land, I directed executive branch agencies to cut spending still more, resulting in a $7.9 million budget surplus at fiscal year end. And the surplus was deposited, as was required by law, into the budget reserve fund. Let's talk about budget reserves. South Dakota is very prudent about using budget reserves. We can be proud of that. When we talk about budget reserves, I'm really talking about the combined balance of two funds, the budget reserve fund, that's the technical term for it, and the General Revenue Replacement Fund. Combined, those are our reserves. This chart shows the balance of those reserve funds as a percentage of our budget over the past 10 years. And as you can see, from fiscal year 09 through fiscal year 11, during those recession years, we had a little over 9% in reserves. Since then, we've maintained reserves at or above 10% of our general fund appropriations. Nationally, for perspective, the median state budget rainy day fund balance is about 6%, with half the states above that and half the states below. Our policy has been to maintain a combined balance of those two accounts equal to 10% of general fund spending. And when our reserves have been in excess of 10%, we have used the extra for one-time expenses, such as debt reduction. Today, we have $165.3 million in reserves, or about 10.5% of our target goal. My recommendation for FY 2018 is to use that portion beyond 10%
to help cover our current year shortfall, specifically for education funding. And I'll explain more about that in a minute. But first, let's take a look at some economic trends. South Dakota's economy, the Bureau of Finance and Management, and the South Dakota Council of Economic Advisors, they regularly review a wide range of economic indicators, which are used to forecast future tax revenue. Reviewing this information with economic experts from across the state helps us provide the best economic and revenue forecasts for the budget each year. Let's take a look at some of those economic forecasts. First, let's look at national forecasts. The Council of Economic Advisors and our BFM staff, they look at national forecasts from a consultant as a baseline to provide a revenue forecast for the major sources of revenue, such as the sales tax. IHS Market is our primary consultant. I think that jumped ahead. There we go. IHS Market is our primary consultant that produces a monthly national economic forecast. Most recent national forecast from IHS Market is that the real GDP growth from the United States will grow 2.4% in 2018 and 2.2% in 2019. The South Dakota economic forecast is a little more conservative, which is consistent with the views of the Council of Economic Advisors. And this South Dakota forecast was used to develop the revenue projections that I'm presenting to you today. We expect positive economic growth, but need to be cautious given recent sluggish revenue growth. Inflation is an important variable because inflation has a direct impact on the growth of our sales tax. Higher inflation creates stronger growth in sales tax revenue, but lower inflation, as we've experienced the past several years, leads to slower growth in sales taxes. Inflation is anticipated to be in the 1.7 to 2.2% range over the next 2 years, slightly stronger than in recent past, but still less than historically seen. The forecast assumes no economic recession will occur, nor a major disruption from abroad, and it also assumes steady housing and construction activity over the next 2 years. Finally, as you know, agriculture is a major cornerstone of our state's economy, and drought conditions in much of the state this growing season exacerbated the impact of low prices, which will likely result in the fourth year of declining farm income since 2013. The forecast projects that calendar year 2017 will be near a low in terms of farm income, with perhaps some marginal improvement in calendar year 2018 if normal production levels return. This, of course, can depend on the weather as well as federal trade policy. These charts show most recent forecasts by IHS Market for the U.S. economy using four indicators. The gray bars, the dark bars there, show the calendar year actual figures, and the blue bars are the forecasts. The first chart, top left, shows U.S. real gross domestic product in trillions of dollars. Real GDP is considered the most comprehensive measure of the U.S. economy, and real GDP has realized steady growth since the recession ended. IHS Market forecasts more than $17 trillion of real GDP in 2018 and 2019 at growth rates of 2.4 and 2.2%, respectively. I mentioned that earlier. The top right chart shows U.S. employment. Job growth is forecast at 1.3% for 2018 and 1.1% for 2019. The bottom left chart shows millions of U.S. housing starts. In 2017, housing starts have been flat, but they are anticipated to grow at a steady pace in 2018 and 2019. The bottom right chart shows the U.S. inflation rate. Over the past 4 years, we've experienced low inflation, almost zero in 2015. Inflation in 2018 and 2019 is predicted to increase 1.7% and 2.2%, respectively. Next, let's consider four South Dakota-specific economic indicators: employment, non-farm income, housing starts, and unemployment. Again, these forecasts are for South Dakota's economy and were used to project revenue for FY18 and 19. Remember, these forecasts from IHS Market were adjusted to be more conservative, consistent with the Council of Economic Advisers' views. First, let's look top left, South Dakota employment. During the recession, South Dakota did realize job losses, but only about half the rate of the U.S. economy. We recovered those jobs more quickly than the nation. In recent months, our employment growth has slowed, and we anticipate continued slow growth in both 2018 and 2019. The chart on the top right, South Dakota non-farm income. South Dakota non-farm income is forecast to grow 3.3% and 3.8% in 2018 and 2019, lower than historical growth rates. Bottom left is South Dakota housing starts. Housing starts have been down, as you can see, in 2017 compared to an unusually strong year in 2016, but are expected to be at healthy levels in 2018 and 2019 of around 5,000 housing starts. The last chart, bottom right, is South Dakota unemployment. After levels of 5% or worse during 2009 and 2010, South Dakota unemployment declined to a low of 2.8% in 2016. So far, it's increased slightly to 3.5%, but we anticipate it will average about 3.1% on an annual basis over the next 2 years. The bottom line, the moderated forecasts indicate a cautious outlook for the South Dakota economy. We should continue to be conservative in economic and revenue forecasts as in the past. Now, when we look at revenues, general fund revenues, we must remember that sales and use taxes make up nearly 63%. It's our largest revenue source by far, 63%. It can be volatile month to month, and it's important to track sales taxes as we make budget decisions. Let's look at some trends we've been seeing in the sales tax base. This is taxable sales now. This chart tracks monthly taxable sales, not the sales tax, but the taxable sales upon which the tax is levied. It shows about 120 months of history back to 2007, and it's been smoothed using a 12-month moving average. You can see from 2012 to 2014, we experienced steady growth, but growth has been slowing since 2015. You can notice on the right side of the chart, the past 3 years, we've been nearly flat. Later, we'll talk about the reasons why our sales tax has been sluggish recently. Let's look at it on annual basis. This chart, again, shows taxable sales by fiscal year. In normal years, we can expect some growth. Notice that fiscal year 11, for example, had very strong growth. Fiscal year 2014 had strong growth. 15 and 16 had slightly more taxable sales. We actually had a decrease in taxable sales in fiscal year 17. Let's look at some recent monthly data to see how our sales tax has performed in recent months. This chart shows the most recent 16 months of sales tax growth rates, measured on a year-over-year growth rate. And the months in 2017 were adjusted to remove the impact of the half-penny sales tax, so it'd be apples-to-apples comparison. As we saw earlier, fiscal year 2017 was a challenging year, with eight of 12 months showing lower tax collections than the previous year, even after adjusting. In a more recent month, we've seen some improvement, but looking at the far right side of the chart, you can see the 4% growth is the line. We need that growth on average to meet our adopted FY18 sales tax estimate. This added red line shows the year-to-date growth as it progressed each month. So in fiscal year 2017, you can see we finished the year with a decrease for the year of 1.6%. Remember, for comparison purposes, again, FY2017 growth rates were adjusted to remove the half penny. So comparing 4% to 4%, we actually collected less sales tax in FY2017 than in 2016. Through the first 4 months of 2018 fiscal year, we're up 2.3% compared to a year ago. It's certainly good to see the sales tax has improved in 3 out of 4 months. But we're still a little bit below the adopted growth rate needed of 4%. And so what we're doing now, we've added a revised growth rate of sales tax that I'm recommending to you today. It's revised down to 3%, about 1% lower than the original adopted estimate. And that's the FY 18 projected revenue as adjusted. We showed this chart previously with just a history of taxable sales. Now at the right, we have added the estimated 2018 taxable sales, shaded in the far right column. You can notice a slight improvement from 2017, which again represents the revised 3% growth, but still relatively flat as compared to the previous three fiscal year. Before we cover the revenue forecast, now let's discuss some reasons why our sales tax has been soft in recent years. What are some of the factors that are contributing to sales tax weakness? First, low farm income. As we've mentioned before, farm income has been lower, leading to lower spending, both directly and indirectly in rural areas of the state. Second, low inflation. As another factor, low inflation that we've experienced over the past several years has limited the growth in our sales tax base. As a third factor, e-commerce. Continued growth of e-commerce spending continues to be a concern because sales tax is not being collected on a portion of these sales by out-of-state businesses. Finally, the ever-increasing cost of healthcare in our country is crowding out income and spending, especially discretionary spending, that could be spent on taxable goods and services. And now I'd like to look at each one of these four factors a little more closely. First, farm income. Agriculture, of course, plays a very important role in South Dakota's economy. The blue bars, measured against the left-hand members in blue, show South Dakota net farm income on a calendar year basis. These are calendar year blue bars. Look at 2002, 2006, and 2012. You can see the income drop during those drought years. Look at 2008 and later. Income is strong with high crop prices and big harvests in most years. Calendar year 2012 was a drought year, but crop insurance locked in spring prices, which were still high. From calendar year 2014 to 16, farm income dropped each year. And in 2017 calendar year, income is expected to be lower yet again due to drought conditions and continued low crop prices. So what does this mean for our budget? Of course, there's a significant indirect impact as lower farm incomes mean less spending in all sectors of our economy. The most direct impact is on sales tax receipts on farm machinery. And as you know, in South Dakota, many purchases by ag producers are exempt from sales tax, but sales and use tax does apply to farm machinery. The red line, defined by the red numbers on the right, estimates farm machinery sales tax collections, and this is fiscal year data. Look at 2007 and later. Tax incentives and strong farm income fueled strong machinery purchases. Sales taxes grew from $17.4 million in FY08 to nearly $45 million in FY14. This boosted our tax revenue during those years and helped our economy through the recession. But today we see fewer farm machinery purchases and less sales taxes, consequently. Since the peak in fiscal year 2014, sales taxes on machinery have dropped more than 50%. Lower net farm income means less farm machinery sales taxes. Now let's look at the second factor, inflation. This graph shows annual inflation rates as measured by the Consumer Price Index, excluding housing and rent prices. We don't pay sales taxes on rent. We don't pay sales taxes when you make a mortgage payment or buy a house. This is national data, by the way, and because changes in housing prices do not have a direct impact on the South Dakota sales tax base, those prices have been excluded. So these bars more closely reflect the price change in our sales tax base. From 1997 through 2012, you can see this indexed average 2.3% growth per year. But with everything else held constant, price inflation contributes to sales tax growth. With consumers purchasing the same volume of goods and services at higher prices, they'll pay higher taxes. But now look at the far right, the past 4 years. From 2013 to 2016, this same index has only increased 0.3% on average. Low inflation means lower growth in our sales and use tax collections, certainly one of the reasons why our sales tax base has experienced slower growth in recent years. Now let's look at the third factor I mentioned, the e-commerce. This chart shows the growth of United States retail e-commerce as published by the Census Bureau since the year 2000. These are quarterly figures, and most recently in the third quarter of 2017, e-commerce sales totaled $115.3 billion nationwide, representing 9.1% of total retail sales. Remember that, 9.1% of total retail sales. In recent years, e-commerce sales have been increasing at a rate in excess of 15%, year over year, jumping 15%. But today, still, collectively, about 9.1% of total retail sales. So let's put that in perspective. This chart has the same data, but the scale has been modified, and we've stacked the bar to show total retail sales and that 9.1%. So of the 1.3 trillion total sales, e-commerce is 115.3 billion, or about, as I said, 9% of the total. So the point is, while e-commerce activity continues to grow, 9% is still a relatively small percentage of total retail sales in the United States. But what about South Dakota? A question we continue to analyze is, how much in taxes does South Dakota lose from e-commerce sales? Well, this pie chart first reminds us that in South Dakota, we have a very broad sales and use tax on most goods and services. E-commerce sales of goods may be rapidly growing, but e-commerce services, not as much. You can't get a haircut online. You can't get your car repaired online. Many services are likely still being taxed, meaning one-third of our sales tax base is probably not as vulnerable to e-commerce losses. Focusing on the taxable goods then, what share in South Dakota of goods are purchased via e-commerce? It's a difficult question to answer. If we assume 9% from the national retail sales figures, it would be about, well, something less than 6% of our total sales tax base, as our tax base, as I mentioned, includes services. In other words, 9% of that 63% in yellow represents less than 6% of the total. Another question we have to ask is, how much of that is already taxed and captured today? We know many online sellers like Amazon are voluntary payers in support of the streamlined sales tax initiative, and others were encouraged by Senate Bill 106 from the 2016 session. So some out-of-state sellers are volunteering their sales tax. And we also know some retailers in South Dakota that have South Dakota stores also have significant e-commerce. Stores like Walmart, Best Buy, Cabela's, they are remitting all the sales tax on e-commerce and in-store sales as well. The problem is, some of them file a combined tax return and they don't show how much is from the e-sales and how much is from in-store sales. So it's hard to know exactly how much tax is related to e-commerce versus traditional retail for those sellers. So the point is, we know some companies are still not remitting tax, but the amount is hard to know. We previously estimated a $50 million loss of state and municipal sales taxes, but we continue to analyze the amount of this loss as we fight e-commerce battle through the court system. The last factor, the fourth factor that I mentioned earlier that I'm going to talk about, is healthcare spending. This graph shows the percentage of total South Dakota consumer spending, which is healthcare spending, as measured by the Bureau of Economic Analysis. This is not spending by state government. This is spending on outpatient services and hospital and nursing home services by consumers. It also does not include spending on health insurance. It's just spending by consumers directly on those costs. Health insurance premiums have been going up, but that's not included on this chart. In 1997, you can see South Dakota consumers spent about 15% of their total spending on healthcare costs, about $2.1 billion. On the far right, by 2016, that percentage had increased to 20.5%, a shift of 5.5% of additional spending on healthcare over the past 20 years. The change means South Dakota consumers are spending $1.85 billion on healthcare, which is not taxable, instead of taxable goods or services. If that $1.85 billion was being spent instead on taxable goods and services, that would equate to more than $80 million. in state sales taxes today. So the increase in healthcare spending has eroded the sales tax base. Now, with that background on economic conditions and on the sales tax, let's look at the full revenue picture in dollars, including the revisions for the current year, fiscal year 2018, and estimates for budget year, fiscal year 2019. In this chart, see the adopted FY18 column. This was our ongoing revenue forecast adopted last March for this year, 2018 fiscal year. The adopted fiscal year total was, as you can see, $1,590.1 million at the bottom of that first numerical column. The next column shows today's revised projection, and the last column shows our total ongoing revenue projection is down $20.3 million. Sales and use tax is revised lower by $9.7 million. We discussed at length some of the weakness we've seen recently. Lottery has been revised higher slightly by 0.1 million. This includes instant, online, and video lottery receipts to the general fund. Video lottery is currently running 4% higher than a year ago. Contractors excise tax has been revised lower by 7.9 million. So far this fiscal year, we've been lower compared to very strong collections a year ago. We still anticipate healthy housing and construction activity, but just not at the level that was originally budgeted. Insurance company tax is down $6.1 million as collections finished 2017 lower than anticipated. We can expect growth compared to a year ago, but just less than was adopted. The remaining revisions roughly offset one another. Total ongoing receipts, $1,569.8 million, which again is $20.3 million lower than adopted last March. And remember this 20.3 lower figure. We'll talk again about this in a minute. But let's talk about FY19 projected revenue. You just add a column. This chart adds that FY19 ongoing receipts column. The far right column shows the change in millions as compared to the FY18 adopted estimate. Sales and use tax, starting on the left, $989 million was the adopted FY18 estimate. $979.3 is the revised estimate today for this year. And for next year, FY19, I recommend a forecast of $1,016.9 million. The increase of $27.9 million is shown in the far right column compared to, again, the FY2018 adopted figure. This represents how much new sales tax we'll have for new FY19 expenses. Lottery, you can see, is projected to grow $3.3 million. The next three revenue sources in the right column, you'll see we're being cautious with our projections, forecasting a decrease in contractors' excise tax, insurance company tax, and unclaimed property as measured against the FY18 adopted figure. License permits and fees estimate is up $4.9 million, primarily normal growth in security fees. Other ongoing receipts growth of $4.4 million includes transfers to the general fund from the South Dakota Housing Authority and the State Veterans Home Operating Fund. In total, for FY2019, I'm proposing a revenue forecast of $1,622.5 million. And this is $32.4 million higher than the adopted FY18 forecast, meaning, again, we have $32.4 million in new ongoing revenue in FY19. Now, against that 32.4 number, let's consider proposed expenses. First, an overview. Due to lack of revenue growth, I cannot recommend inflationary increase at all for education or Medicaid providers or state employee salaries. My budget does include the following increases. For education, I'm proposing funding tied to increased student enrollment. For Medicaid providers, 2 years ago, you'll recall we began a plan to move community-based providers' rates to at least 90% of their actual costs. Over 3 years, we've been working toward that, and this year I'm recommending funding to complete that plan. And then thirdly, for state employees, although I'm recommending a 0% salary increase across the board, my proposal does include funding to keep some employees' compensation from falling further behind the market. And I'll explain more in detail about that later. But let's take a look at the dollar costs of these overall recommendations. For education, total dollar increases of $20,331,000. For medical services and provider assistance, total increases of $11.3 million. Protecting people is $2.6 million. State employees, that minimum amount, $630,000. Title 19 Medicaid FMAC savings is actually a benefit to its lower expenses of $9.8 million. Miscellaneous increases and decreases of $2.4 million. And then Building South Dakota, I'm showing that as an expense of $4.9 million. This is cost neutral because the revenue estimate that I'm offering includes increased revenue related to that. I'll address that in more detail later. So as you can see, this totals to the $32.4 million in increases that we showed in the projected revenue matching up with that projection. So now let's look at each one of those line items in detail. Let's begin with the $20,331,660 for education. State aid to education is $16.1 million of that. That's primarily increased enrollments in the K-12 districts. In FY19, we project enrollments to grow by almost 1,900 students. And this includes an increase in students who qualify as English language learners, which count as an additional quarter of a student for each one of them in the formula. Maintenance repair for the Board of Regents and the Technical Institutes, $1 million. Several years ago, I proposed and you adopted a plan to bring maintenance and repair budgets to 2% of the replacement value of our state buildings over the course of 4 years. We reached this goal in 2017 budget year, but we retreated from it to balance the budget. After updating building valuations this year, we've fallen further below that 2% mark. My recommendation for this year would be to get the Board of Regents to 1.76% so that we don't fall even further behind. I'm also recommending funding to begin a 6-year plan to get the state-owned Technical Institutes buildings to 2%. The next line item, Board of Regents utilities. Utility expenses at the Board of Regents are projected to increase $894,000. South Dakota Opportunity Scholarship, $614,000. The 2015 legislature increased this scholarship to $6,500 per student with a 4-year phase-in. This is the fourth and final year of the phase-in. This funding helps keep the scholarship competitive as an incentive for students to take rigorous high school curriculum and stay in South Dakota for college. 4,188 recipients are projected for the coming school year. The next line item, Technical Institutes, $558,000, and this corresponds to a projected enrollment growth of 160 students in FY19. Dual credit increases, $399,000. The number of students taking dual credit courses continues to increase. This funding is for an additional 4,129 credits in fiscal year 19 over the current FY18 numbers. Finally, there's miscellaneous increases and decreases of $702,000, all total to the $20.3 million we saw in the prior chart. Now let's look at the items which are the second item on the big chart, which add up to $11.3 million for medical and provider assistance. This second category of medical and provider assistance provides mandatory inflation of $5.4 million, and these inflationary adjustments are required by the federal government and vary across services such as Medicare and certain federally qualified rural health clinics. Second, growth and utilization of $4.8 million. In FY19, we project an additional 945 persons will enroll in Medicaid. That's 0.8% growth. I might mention, during the recession, we were adding 1,000 people a month to the Medicaid rolls. So to see 945 over the course of the entire fiscal year 19 is really very slow growth. Rural Family Residency Track, $180,000. Last year, you funded startup costs for a rural family practice physician residency program. The program has now received initial accreditation, and this $180,000 funds year one of a three-year implementation plan to add two residents each year for 3 years. Data shows that the majority of doctors stay to practice in the state in which they complete their residency program. And with the expansion of the medical school in South Dakota graduates more physicians each year than we have residency positions. And when this program is complete, there'll be additional 6 residency slots in South Dakota, so we will export fewer trained physicians and keep more of them in a residency in South Dakota, especially in rural communities where our need is most critical. The next item, mental health court, $139,000. This is funding to the treatment portion of the mental health court pilot program in Pennington County. Then miscellaneous increases and decreases, $775,000 throughout the departments of social services, health, and human services. Then finally, the South Dakota Healthcare Solutions Coalition. You can see a negative number and a positive number. As stated earlier, 2 years ago, I proposed and you adopted a plan to increase community-based providers to at least 90% of costs over 3 years. This year, my recommendations include funding that will complete that 3-year plan, and this will be funded using savings generated by the South Dakota Healthcare Solutions Coalition's work to implement a federal policy for the federal government to pay the full bill when Indian Health Service refers Medicaid patients to other providers. You can see the slide includes a savings of $4.5 million and an expense in the same amount as these funds are used to increase rates. So the total increase on that chart for medical and provider assistance is that number you saw earlier on the other chart, $11.3 million. Next, we'll look at the detail for the $2.5 million under protecting people. This third category of protecting people includes correctional health care expense of $1.3 million for costs associated with providing medical and mental health care to adult offenders. It also includes DOC Community Transition Program costs of $1.1 million. And this program would provide community placements for parolees to save on operational costs such as staff and health care within the prisons. Thirdly, mental health court, $109,000. This funding would establish a mental health court in Pennington County to more effectively identify and treat people with mental illness who are entering the criminal justice system. Then miscellaneous increases and decreases, nearly $15,000. It includes various operating expenses at adult correctional facilities, decreases within juvenile corrections due to the declining juvenile population, and an increase in security staff at the community work centers. The total increase related to protecting people, $2.6 million. The fourth line item on the major chart is, I'm also proposing almost $632,000 to address low pay for certain state employees. As I said, I'm recommending no salary increase or market adjustment for most state employees for the second year in a row, and no movement toward market value or pay for performance. We just can't afford it. I'm also recommending no increased state support for state employee health plan costs, even as ever-rising health care costs will force changes to our health plan, which will impact state employees. As we minimize that impact as much as possible, we will likely deplete our current health plan reserve and put more expense on those employees and their dependents. For a pay range to address employee market minimum, $632,000 nearly, to keep some employee pay, which is already lower than market, from falling even farther behind the market. And I'm going to walk you through an example, so this comes down to human terms. I'm going to use a caseworker, which is one of the jobs that would be affected by this. And there's about 15,000 jobs like this. The average market salary for this job currently is $21.70 an hour. And how do we know what that is? Because we survey the market every year, and we have a very comprehensive survey every 4 years, which we just completed. So the average wage in the market among private employers and other government employers is $21.70. This is where we'd like the salary of our fully proficient employees to be. The hiring point, or the target minimum, for a new employee in this job would be $18.45 an hour, which is 85% of that average market wage. However, we're currently hiring new employees for this job at $15 an hour, because that's all we can afford. We call this our artificial minimum, or the current minimum, as you can see in this slide. My proposal would allow us to move minimum pay for this job from $15 an hour to $15.87 an hour. This doesn't get us to our target minimum, but it prevents us from falling further behind. As average market wage goes up in fiscal year 19, we won't fall further behind. Addressing this now to the extent we can will avoid more expensive problems down the road. And as I said, this will affect approximately 1,500 current employees. The fifth major expense that's is actually helpful to our budget, the Federal Medical Assistance Percentage, or FMAP, which is the federal government's share of each Medicaid payment, will increase for FY19, meaning our state share of each payment will go down. Let's look at FMAP history. This chart shows the changes of the federal and state share of Medicaid payments to providers. The federal share is shown by the red line. It's called the Federal Medical Assistance Percentage, or FMAP. That's the federal share. Because the FMAP is increasing here in the last 3 years, our state share, the blue line, will go down by 1.13% to 43.63% of each payment. So why is this happening? Well, our FMAP rate is determined by comparing South Dakota's personal income change over 3 years, looking back 3 years, what's our personal income change as compared to the United States personal income change average over the last 3 years. You'll remember that FY2011 was enhanced under the stimulus, so that's why there's a big gap there. But in fiscal years 2012 through 16, our three-year trailing average of personal income was growing faster than the United States personal income was growing, in part because of high farm income, because farm income gets figured into that assessment. Since then, though, since our farm income started falling, our three-year average has slowed compared to the rest of the nation. So the increased FMAP in 2019 will save state general funds in five different departments across the state budget. The total savings is almost $9.8 million. Aside from some other miscellaneous increases and decreases, the last major item I want to detail is Building South Dakota. It's shown as an expense, but it's offset by an increase in general fund revenue. Let me explain that. Our current law includes several statutes that define how revenue flows into Building South Dakota, how those dollars are allocated among five different funds, and how those funds are spent. It's become very complicated. A few years ago, you might remember, we allocated a large sum of one-time money to Building South Dakota with the hope that the program could sustain itself for 3 years. In fact, those funds have lasted for 4 years. Looking forward, however, the ongoing revenue sources that fund Building South Dakota are very volatile and unpredictable. Currently, Building South Dakota receives funding in two ways, you can see at the top. First, if the Board of Economic Development approves a reinvestment payment for a construction project over $20 million, then the contractor's excise tax for that project flows to Building South Dakota. And that varies greatly year to year because it flows at the end of the project, when the project is complete. And usually there's a delay of 2 or 3 years from the time a project is approved to when it is completed and the contractor's excise tax is transferred. Secondly, there's a statute that states that if the budget reserve funds are over 10% of our general fund budget and Building South Dakota funds are less than 1% of our general fund budget, then funds are transferred to Building South Dakota. And those conditions have never occurred. I would like to propose that we make this much simpler. My budget would take the approximately $3 million per year in contractors' excise tax that's currently diverted to Building South Dakota and instead direct it back to the general fund. Then I'm proposing that we allocate $3 million in general funds, the same amount, into the funds that make up Building South Dakota. In addition, the Housing Development Authority has committed $1.5 million in ongoing funds for the next 5 years annually, and we've also committed $400,000 annually from the Private Activity Bond Fund. So all told, this would be a commitment of $4.9 million in ongoing general funds that could be in turn spent in the General Appropriations Bill for Building South Dakota. This proposal would eliminate the 5% stream of dollars that's currently allocated to the Ready Fund and would allocate the dollars instead to the four remaining funds: Housing Opportunity $1.9 million, Local Infrastructure $1.5 million, Workforce Education $1.125 million, and Economic Development Partnership $375,000. And I believe that allocation closely mirrors the current allocation and the level of utilization each program has seen. But I'm certainly open to rebalancing that through the appropriations process. If we make this change, these four funds will exist in the General Appropriations Act each year rather than relying on a complicated and unreliable side statute. This will make it easier for legislators to weigh the relative benefits of each fund and to allocate future revenue increases as our needs change. If my proposed legislation does not pass, the $3 million in contractors' excise tax would continue to be withheld from the general fund for Building South Dakota, and that's why this proposal is revenue neutral. We're adding $3 million to the general fund and putting $3 million of spending in the general bill from those dollars, along with the 1.5 and the 4 from the other two sources. Unless this program is abolished entirely, there's no way to redirect those funds elsewhere because they won't exist in the general bill. So this slide once again summarizes all those major spending changes in the budget that I'm proposing today. The net spending increase of $32.4 million mirrors the increase in projected revenue for FY19. So now that we've discussed the proposed FY19 budget, let's go back to 2018, the year we're in right now. We've got 7 months to go in the year, but we know we're going to have a revenue shortage if things continue to go. And remember, as described earlier, our most recent projections today are that our revenue will be $20.3 million less than our adopted expenditures. That's the adopted expenditures and revenue we adopted last March. In addition to the $20.3 million revenue shortfall, we also have $10.4 million in additional FY18 expenses as well. Let's look at those increased expenses. State aid education, $9 million. This increase is due to some of the same factors we mentioned earlier. First, the number of student enrollments compared to what was estimated is about 450 more students that enrolled. Second, the number of English language learners is up, and as I said earlier, we pay an extra 25% for each student who are English language learners. Third, dual credits. Again, for FY18, we're projecting 2,882 more credits than budgeted. And then fourth, property valuations are a little lower than projected, which reduces the amount of money that schools are getting from their local property taxpayers, which raises the amount that we must then pay them to fill up to the per student evaluation. The second item on that list is utility rate and food service adjustments of $617,000. They're due to increased costs and usage in the current year utility and food service budgets in various agencies. The technical school are seeing also increased enrollment. They're seeing 103 more students enrolled than previously budgeted. That's costing us $358,000 more. And miscellaneous increases of $394,000 includes $320,000 for the Obligation Recovery Center for recovery fees, which is a net impact of zero to the general fund because it means we're also collecting more debt than we anticipated. Collections for FY18 are projected to increase $1.4 million over budgeted levels, and most of these funds do not go to the general fund, but instead go to the court system, municipalities, and counties. But it's an indicator of a good thing because we're collecting more debts than we would otherwise have anticipated. Then I'm also recommended $3 million in emergency special appropriations for FY2018. Adding in these appropriations brings our total shortfall to $33.7 million. And let's take a look at those special appropriations in detail. First, healthcare recruitment assistance program, almost $838,000. This funding will pay for healthcare professionals such as physicians, dentists, nurse practitioners, pharmacists, so on, who have met their three commitment to practice in rural areas, and now we owe them a reimbursement of their tuition. Second, wildland fire suppression fund is $766,000 is to backfill the fire fund for wildland fires that have taken place in the past year. Aviation support facility, $500,000. This will provide a portion of the funding needed for year one of 3 years to pay for an aviation support facility for the Army National Guard at the Rapid City Regional Airport. We were able to move up the federal project list, and total funding needed from state sources will be $5 million over 3 years, with an additional $15 million from the federal government. The next item, tax refunds for the elderly, you've seen before. This is an annual appropriation that pays for refunds of sale taxes or property taxes for elderly and disabled persons that meet low-income guidelines. The Extraordinary Litigation Fund, $424,000. This is to backfill the Extraordinary Litigation Fund for litigation expenses not covered by the People Fund, the public entity pool for liability. And in total, as you can see, this is just under the $3 million of special appropriations. So here again is the total shortfall of $33.7 million for the year we're in right now. And here is how I'm proposing to fill it. First, we're going to reduce expenses by $16 million. And let's look at what those reductions are. The Department of Social Services utilization, again, I remarked how slowly our enrollment growth is as compared to what it was during the recession. So we're going to reduce the number of people we project eligible for Medicaid services to follow the trend we've been seeing. Second, the Department of Social Services program funds, $5.8 million. This includes using $3 million in temporary assistance for needy family funds, $2 million of prescription drug rebate funds, and $800,000 in SNAP funds. Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, formerly food stamp. From the Department of Human Services, we're projecting lower utilization, again, like much like the Medicaid enrollment, that impacts human services, reductions in long-term services and supports, and developmental disabilities based on current projections, and also a reduction at the South Dakota Development Center in Redfield due to our initiative to right-size that program. Next, the DOC juvenile utilization is down due to the declining juvenile population and the upcoming sale of Star Academy. This assumes we will get the Star Academy sold and get over $500,000 of expense off the books, annual expense. From public safety, state radio, $100,000 reduction based on current expenses, and a fire premium refund update, $20,000 of adjustment to the fire premium refund continuous appropriation based on actual figures. So you can see all those reductions total $16 million, and that will cover part of the gap. The other part of the gap is the use of one-time cash resources. And so we'll look at that next. The $17.7 million is made up by quite a few things. The budget reserve, we will propose to transfer $7.2 million from the budget reserve. That'll still keep our reserve at 10%, but it uses the excess, that $7.2 million. And that will be used to cover most of our FY2018 shortfall in state aid to education. From Health and Education Facilities Authority, $2.5 million to cover the rest of the shortfall in education funding and to cover our rural health care recruitment incentive obligations. Because, you know, that authority has to spend money on education and health care. The rest of this list includes cash resources within the various departments, which you can see on the slide. Department of Human Services homemaker fees, $2 million. Petroleum Release Compensation Fund, $1.3 million. Department of Ed Workforce Education Fund, $793,000. Department of Human Services Telecommunication Relay Services, $750,000. Department of Human Services Prescription Drug Fund, $750,000. Department of Education E-Rate Funds, $500,000. Video Lottery Fund, $500,000. Court Automation Fund, $500,000. Private Activity Bond Fund, Bond Fee Fund, $481,000. Finance and Management Budgetary Accounting Fund, $261,000, and Veterans Home Operating Funds, $120,000. All total, $17.7 million. So that those two items cover the shortfall of $33.7 million in the current fiscal year. Again, proposing reducing expenses by approximately $16 million and utilizing $17.7 million of cash resources. And to put this in perspective, this $33.7 million is about 2% of our general fund budget and about 0.7% of our total budget. So it's a hole, but put it in perspective another way, Moody's reported when the fiscal year began, about a dozen states didn't even have a budget yet. Montana just finished their special session to fix their budget hole. Oklahoma had an 8-week special session that ended up in failure, and they're probably going to have to get back together to fill a $250 million budget hole. So all things considered, I think we're in relatively good shape. I wish we had better revenue growth. We wish we didn't have these unforeseen expenses. But again, all things considered, we're in pretty good shape. So here's a final look at FY18 and 19. I'm proposing a revised budget in 2018 of $4.6 billion and recommending $4.7 billion in total spending for 2019. The recommended FTE for 2019 are 13,905.9. Full-time equivalent employees in agencies under my direct control are still 116 fewer than when I took office in 2011. Both years are honestly balanced with ongoing expenses for FY19 fully supported by only ongoing revenue. And there again is a distinction from some other states. In Illinois, they are very clearly funding ongoing expenses with one-time revenue and much of it through borrowing. And that's not something we're doing. We're honestly balancing our budget with ongoing revenue only being used for ongoing expenses. In closing, South Dakota is working. We're working better than many other states. We can proudly say that we've structurally balanced our budget honestly without gimmicks, and this is our 129th year of a balanced budget, which is honestly balanced. We've prudently maintained a 10% reserve. We have one of the strongest pension plans in the nation. S&P just released a report a couple months ago that identified South Dakota among the top 170 plans in the nation. We're one of five they held up as examples. We have placed improvements in our financial practice into statute to help guide our state for the long term. After we're gone, others in our place will follow these statutes, hopefully. And all of these practices are paying dividends. South Dakota holds the top credit rating from all three major credit rating agencies. And I'm very proud of the achievements on this slide. They aren't my achievements. Aren't really our achievements. They reflect the discipline and maturity that you've shown as legislators, that many past governors and legislators have shown. And we should never take that for granted. Every year, our continued prosperity is never guaranteed. We must be ever watchful and not take that for granted. Many other states find themselves in dire straits today because they failed to maintain that discipline that I'm proud South Dakota has historically maintained. I hope you're proud of these accomplishments also. I look forward to working with you together this year to help South Dakota maintain a sound financial footing. Thank you very much for your attention today. Mr. Speaker.
forth and prosper, and don't spend beyond your means. Have a great day. We'll see you in January.
And that will conclude Governor Dennis Daugaard's budget address. He gave his recommendations for fiscal year 2019, although there was much talk about tweaking the budget for 2018 due to low sales tax that are coming in. One of the things that the governor talked about at the end was there are a lot of states that are in serious situations because their budgets are in such bad shape. He stressed that South Dakotans, South Dakota lawmakers, should be proud of the fact that historically they have balanced their budget here, and they will continue to do so. One of the things he mentioned, the South Dakota economic forecast still calls for positive growth, which is good. He just stresses that lawmakers need to be cautious as they move forward. His recommendations are coming from the South Dakota Council of Economic Advisors. They developed the revenue projections that were presented today. One of the things talked about right away was the shortfall from fiscal year 2018. $33.7 million from fiscal year 18 is the shortfall. He talked about his ideas on how we fill that. A couple of different ways to do that are going to be some reduction in expenses, which will come from a variety of sources. The governor also talked about some one-time cash resources of about $17.6 million. So between $17.6 million in a one-time cash, if you will, advance to the general fund and a $16 million reduction in expenses, it should fill that $33 million shortfall that the governor talked about today for fiscal year 18. Stand by, we're going to be visiting with state lawmakers to hear what they thought about the governor's recommendations, to also get their take on the 2018 legislative session, which is just around the corner. If you missed any of today's speech, you can find it archived at sdpb.org. You can also visit us on Facebook and Twitter at SDPB News, where we will have everything archived, including our reporters that have been following the governor's speech all day, bringing you insights and information and numbers and clips from the slides as the governor presented his last budget address as the governor of South Dakota. We're going to start doing some interviews now. I'm going to throw it to SDPB Radio, Lee Stribinger. Lee, go ahead.
Thank you for joining me down here on the floor.
Yeah, you bet.
What are your thoughts on the governor's presentation?
I thought it was a good budget presentation. The budget, of course, is balanced, and it reflects a tough ag economy. So our sales tax collections are down. It reflects the fact that, you know, 9% of all the retail sales are online and increasing, and that's a big issue for our budget here in South Dakota. So it's a modest budget with no inflationary increases for K-12, Medicaid providers, or state employees. Just a reality.
The fiscal year 18 budget is still giving us some trouble. The governor wants to reduce it by 33.7 million more, and even using dipping into the reserves. You know, I guess, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, we don't have a choice. I mean, we're not going to spend money that we don't have, and if there's some money available in the reserves, we'll go take a look. I think it's a solid approach to balancing the budget.
How is that shortfall, and then the upcoming fiscal year 19 budget, how's that going to impact this upcoming session?
Well, most of the things that we're going to try to do, we're going to have to do without money, honestly, or we're going to have to take money away from someone else, or we're going to have to come up with a new revenue source. If there's things that the legislature decides that they want to do that cost money. And the legislature has some ideas. I mean, I know there are some areas that we need to address, and some of those might involve tax or fee increases in certain limited areas.
Is that taking a look at some of the tax exemptions in the state as well?
I don't know. There's certainly some discussion of that, but Probably not. You know, our health care bills are high enough. I don't see us going to tax health care services. That's a pretty hard thing to do. With the ag economy in the tank, we'd be foolish to try to take away their exemptions, and that pretty much covers 90% of the exemptions in this state between health care and farm, ag.
Speaker Mickelson, thank you so much for joining me. Stephanie, back up to you.
All right, thank you, and thank you to Representative Mark Mickelson as well. Now I'm joined by Senator Reynold Nisiba. Senator, you heard the speech today, your second speech that you've heard as a state lawmaker. What did you think so far?
It is, things aren't as bad maybe as some had made them out to be. That is going to be a tight budget year, but there is a plan in place to address those. I was really more concerned by just the lack of an overall vision. So we talk about fiscal deficits, but we don't really talk about the educational deficits in this state. We're one of the last states, perhaps the last state in the country, to have a needs-based scholarship program. So I think we give about $14 for each student who is eligible for a federal Pell Grant in the state of South Dakota, so about $14 on average, whereas a state next to us like Minnesota spends $1,500. And that's one of the reasons why we have a high number of our students in college who have high levels of student debt, both a high number with debt and a high amount of debt. And there's nothing in there. The Board of Regents does have a plan to address that, and I was sad that there was nothing in the governor's address about the Board of Regents plan.
So with that information moving forward, the 2018 legislature will kick off in about 3 to 4 weeks. What are you hoping will take center stage when you come back in January?
Well, and I am on the Appropriations Committee, so I do spend a few hours every day in budget hearings. And so we will be taking a closer look at this. Some of those one-time monies, I think, will get closer scrutiny. We'll keep looking for other places to cut this budget. And I'm hoping that at the end of this year that we can take a step back, and maybe it's time for a summer study for us to really take a look at our tax structure overall. Just is it doing everything that we need it to do? That we do have these other deficits in terms of we don't have a pre-K education program. We're struggling. We're not going to have higher teacher pay. I worry that we're sliding behind in teacher pay because we're not being able to do increases, and we're not meeting the needs of our university students in terms of those with financial needs. So there's other deficits that need to be addressed besides our fiscal ones.
All right. I thank you for your time. We have Senator Reynold Nisiba coming up to us from Sioux Falls. We'll see you back here in January.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Lee, we'll throw it back to you.
Standing here with State Representative David Anderson. He's a representative from District 16 in Hudson. He's also chair of the House Appropriations Committee. What were your thoughts on the governor's budget address?
I think it's a very responsible budget based on the economic conditions that we have. It's, I guess, typical of this governor. He's not going to step out on a limb. And I guess I appreciate the fact that he's offering conservative estimates. If over the next 3 to 4 months we find that we do have some additional revenues, the holiday season, Christmas season, sales tax picks up a little bit, other economic factors improve it, we'll have a chance as a legislature to go back in and look at some of these areas that are not getting increases and perhaps add a little to those areas.
Now, being on the Appropriations Committee, chairing it, you know, we're talking about a $33.7 million reduction in fiscal year 18. I guess, you know, fiscal FY18 keeps giving us, you know, trouble. Could you tell me how appropriations is going to get that done?
Well, as the governor indicated, a couple areas, you know, reduce some spending in certain areas and then withdraw some cash out of some funds that are there. You know, obviously they're there over time to use for those programs, but We do this every year. Periodically, we draw down funds. The court automation fund is an example that he mentioned, and we did that last year as well. We took some money out of there. It's a fund that has a stream of income that's coming into it all the time from a very particular source, and the courts use that money for their court automation, obviously, but they haven't been using it as rapidly as the funds have flowed into it. And so periodically we go in and we pull a little bit out of it. And that's part of what we're doing in lots of different areas.
Representative Anderson, thanks for joining me on the floor. Stephanie, back to you.
All right. Thank you very much. I'm now joined by Representative Ray Ring from Vermilion. Representative, we heard a lot from the governor in his speech today. One of the things we've been hearing more and more about over the last few years is e-commerce and how we continually aren't getting the money that we should be getting. What are your thoughts on that?
I think that is a serious problem. No doubt that the sales tax is down for, or at least not growing as rapidly as we expected, for a number of reasons, including the agricultural economy. But I think we're really being hurt by the erosion of our sales tax base because of the increase in e-commerce. Right after Black Friday, the Wall Street Journal had some articles talking about the huge shift on to e-commerce, and that's obviously hurting us. And at this point, I wish that Congress would do something. Congress could do something about that. The House did, or the Senate did, pass a bill a few years ago, but the House refuses to act. We do have this case out of South Dakota now that we hope the Supreme Court will accept and hope they'll come down with the right decision. If they don't, then these problems with shortages, as long as we're relying so heavily, what the governor says, 63% on the sales tax, then that shortfall is, I think, only going to get worse until we do something about it.
My follow-up question was, the governor mentioned this will continue to be battled in the courts, so it sounds like there's not much more the state legislature can do at this point.
I think that's right. Actually, a couple years ago, I probably would have said I didn't think there was much more than that the legislature could do, and then they came up with SB 106, I think it was, and that's been working its way through the courts. I think it's my impression that's sort of our last best hope. And if that doesn't work, then we're back to begging Congress to do something, which, as you may know, the Supreme Court in their decision, in the Quill decision, suggested to the states, if you don't like this, talk to Congress. But Congress won't do anything.
Before I let you go, this will be the governor's last year. Sometimes they'll refer to that as a lame duck year. Your thoughts on works that could or could not get done this coming session?
Oh, I don't think it will have that much. The fact that he's a lame duck will have that much of an influence on what we get done. It doesn't sound to me like there are any huge issues coming up that are going to take a lot of arm twisting or influence, imposing of the governor's power. And so I don't think things will change all that much.
All right. We look forward to seeing you back here in January. Thank you, Representative Ray Ring of Vermilion.
Thank you very much.
All right, Lee, and we'll throw it back down to you.
Standing here with State Senator Jim Bolin from Canton. He is the chair of the Senate Education Committee. Senator, what are your thoughts on the governor's budget proposal?
Well, I was really glad to see how the governor had worked very diligently to present another balanced budget for the state. There will be, you know, our revenues are not increasing as fast as we thought they would. By the same token, we do have some money in reserve. He's going to use at least 7% of that, or $7 million of that, to try to cushion some of the blows because our revenue is not as strong as we might have anticipated. But I think one of the big questions will be, should we maintain a 10% budget reserve, or should we perhaps go a little bit lower than that and use some of that money to help social services agencies and schools maintain themselves in the last year of his administration? So I think that'll be really the big question. Is 10% a magic number?
How is this, these budget reductions that the governor was proposing, how is it going to impact education in the states?
Well, I think school districts do have some money in reserve. It will, you know, we did increase school funding, especially for teacher salaries, by $60 million a year or two years ago, and I supported that. We'll just have to wait and see. I know most, not all, but most school districts have sufficient reserves to get us through this particular difficult time. But I think we're just, the jury's still out on that at the present time.
Yeah, and some school districts are having trouble meeting those teacher pay increases. Are they going to have to tighten their belts even further?
Perhaps, but I believe this morning the is a Government Accountability Board approved almost all of the waivers. And I think it's also important to remember that the vast majority of those school districts were very small, and most of them were rural, and most of those waivers were granted. So the actual amount of dollars that's going to need to be renegotiated is going to actually be quite small.
You're in the Senate, but the House just recently nominated and voted for Representative Stephen Haugaard to be Speaker pro tem here in the House. Is there anything you can tell us about Representative Haugaard?
I've worked with him when I was in the House for 4 years. He lives in the rural Renner area. He's a lawyer. He's been on the Minnehaha County Board of Mental Health for many years. I get along with him pretty well. I agree with him on most things, but not everything.
Senator Boland, thank you so much for joining me.
Okay,
Stephanie, back to you.
All right. Thank you, Lee, and thank you to Senator Jim Boland from the Canton area. That will conclude South Dakota Public Broadcasting's coverage of the governor's budget address. If you've missed any of it, it is archived at sdpb.org. Just a reminder, SDPB will be back here on January 9th as we kick off the 2018 legislative session. The State of the State address will begin that, and we will remain here throughout the entire run of the upcoming legislative session. You can tune in for daily radio news stories. You can watch us online at sdpb.org as well as sd.net. And of course, live gavel-to-gavel coverage of the House and Senate in a Friday night wrap-up program. On behalf of all of us with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, I'm Stephanie Ristler, Lee Strubinger. We thank you for watching. Goodbye.
Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. Programming is made possible with your annual membership in the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Additional funding provided by...
Today, we're moving the prairie forward. For the farmers and manufacturers, you are our member owners. Together, we are re-energizing rural.
Thanks to SDN Communications CyberRx Security Risk Review, Lucy has a complete IT game plan. She can also rotate from station to station at 1.2 meters per second, rating Lucy's foot speed amongst the elite at her position, allowing her to get the most out of SDN's reliable broadband network and its full suite of managed cybersecurity services. Even IT pros up their game when they partner with SDN. Enjoy the uptime.